Good afternoon and welcome to another online Cisco tutorial. My name is Don Pizzette and today I'm going to give you a quick walkthrough on enabling SSH on a Cisco router or switch. When I get a new piece of Cisco equipment, one of the first things that I do is get it set up to a point where I can remotely connect to it. That way I don't have to work from the console cable while I'm trying to set it up. I don't like to be physically near the equipment. It's noisy and obnoxious, so I try and get the equipment in the server room and me in another office somewhere, then I can remote in and do the rest of my configuration. Now, SSH is actually pretty easy to configure. Remember, we want to use SSH to connect to our systems as opposed to telnet because telnet is an unsecure protocol. It's transmitting our data in plain text. SSH, secure shell, on the other hand, is going to encrypt all of our data as it's transmitted between our workstation and the router itself. Now, a lot of people don't use SSH, and it's a real shame. It does require some extra steps to get it configured, but I'm going to show you right here it can actually be done pretty easily without anything too terribly fancy. I've got a router right here. This is a Cisco 3725, and it's got iOS 12.4 on it, although you'll find these commands don't really vary between the iOSs. And the same goes for switches. The configuration's actually identical. The only thing we need to be concerned about is, first off, we need to make sure that our iOS image supports the encryption feature set. The easiest way to see whether or not you support encryption is if you get into your configuration. I'm just going to get into my configuration here and do a crypto question mark. If you see crypto commands, that lets you know that your router supports cryptography. Or if your iOS file name has a K9 in it, that will let you know that it supports cryptography. We need this for SSH to work. We also need it for VPNs and the secure web services and so forth. So there's other things you need it for, but we're definitely going to need it here for SSH. All right. In order for SSH to work, the most important thing it needs is a certificate that it can use for encrypting and decrypting data. We're going to need to create a certificate. But in order to create a certificate, we need a valid, fully qualified domain name for our router. Now, if we have a real internet registered domain name, we can use that. Or if we're just trying to get this up quick and dirty, we can make up whatever we want. I can assign my router a name. I'll give it a host name here of R1. And I can assign it a domain name. I'll give it demo.net. Now, I'm sure that's a real domain out there that I don't own, but I'm just going to use it here in the example. Doesn't really matter. Nobody's going to see it. So in this case, I'll have r1.demo.net is going to be my host name. Once I've got a host name and a domain name defined, I can now generate a certificate. I'm going to say crypto, which is accessing the cryptography feature set. Key, that lets it know that I'm working with a security key. Generate, I'm creating a new key. And RSA, I want to use the RSA algorithm. Now, in order to support SSH 1.99 or 2.0, we need a key with a 1024-bit modulus. You'll notice when I go to create this key, it defaults to 512, okay? I need to change it to 1024 or I will not get proper SSH support. So I'm going to change that right here. Now, depending on your router, the processor that's inside of it may not be all that great, and so it may take a little while to generate this certificate. This particular router has a very snappy processor, so you'll see it'll generate that certificate pretty fast. As soon as I've got that certificate in place, notice what I just got. SSH 1.99 has been enabled. I'm now running SSH on this router. So the first challenge for getting SSH up and going is now overcome. All right, now the next thing I need is, in order for me to get into this router, I have to have a valid IP address. And this is a brand new non-configured router, so it doesn't actually have an IP address right now. If I do a show IP interface brief, I can see that I've got two interfaces, fast Ethernet 0/0 and 0/1, both of which are administratively down. I'm going to go in and add an IP address to fast Ethernet 0/0. I'm just going to give it a private address, 172.16.0.1. I'll assign that and I'll do a no shutdown to bring that interface online. So that's going to come up. That's an IP that my computer can see, so that'll be useful. There's my status messages letting me know that the line is up, so we're good there. Now we've got an IP address. All right. Now I mentioned that SSH is enabled by default. It's just not functional until we have the certificate. SSH is functional at this point. I can connect to the router and start to work with it. My biggest problem at this point, the only thing actually stopping me from connecting right now, is that when I SSH in, the router is going to ask me for a username and a password. And so I need to define a username and a password. Well, on a Cisco router, we can do that using the username command. So I'll just say username and what I want the name to be. In this case, I'll just say admin. So I'm creating a username admin. Now, I want the username admin to have a full administrative access to this router. So I'm going to give it a privilege level of 15, and then I need to define a password. Now, I can define the password one of two ways, using the password command or using the secret command. Remember that the password command is going to store that password in plain text in the config, whereas the secret command will store it as an MD5 hash. I'm going to use the secret command here and give it a password of password. I'm going really secure here. Here we can spice it up a little bit like Microsoft does and maybe add some special characters in there. There we go. So I've got an at symbol and a zero and a capital P. So now we're a little bit more fancy. All right. So I've got a username. What I'm going to find now is that the router still isn't going to ask me for a username, at least not until I tell it that I want, when somebody logs into a router, to ask for a username and a password. Cisco routers operate in the old model of authentication by default. That means they just ask for a password and not a username. In order to ask for a username also, I need to put myself in the new model for authentication. And I do that with the command AAA new-model. AAA stands for authentication, authorization, and accounting. AAA new model will make it ask for a username as well as a password. All right. The only other password that's really useful for me to set at this point is going to be an enable password. When somebody enables, we need a prompt for a password there. So I'm just going to go ahead and say enable secret, and I'll specify a password. I'll use that same password. No sense being too secure here in our little lab environment. All right. At this point, we're up and going, and I should be able to SSH into this router. There is one other thing that we can do. Technically, I've not only enabled SSH, but I've also enabled telnet at the same time. I may not want to enable telnet. I can go into my VTY lines, my virtual terminal ports, line VTY 0 through 4. These are the five virtual lines that are created on all Cisco routers by default that allows people to telnet and SSH in. On most switches, it's 0 through 15. There's actually 16 lines created on most switches, so you'd need to do 0, 15 on a switch, 0, 4 on a router. I'm going to go into these lines, and I'm going to say transport input SSH. That's going to tell it that I only want to allow SSH on my VTY ports. If I said transport input SSH telnet or transport input all, that would allow all access, any protocol, including telnet, which is non-secure. I'm going to say SSH, which says I only want to allow SSH access on these interfaces. All right, so that should be enough for us here. I'm going to get out of my config. And I'll go ahead and save my configuration, because that's always a good idea. And then I'm going to test it out. Now, I've got an SSH client loaded here on my machine. It's actually the same client I'm using here for my console access. I like to use PuTTY, so I'm going to bring up my PuTTY console. Here we go. And I've already created a little shortcut here for my SSH connection. It's just going to plug in my IP address and configure SSH. So let me go ahead and punch that in, and I'll go ahead and connect. Now, in my SSH window, when I first launch it, I'm going to get this pop-up box right here warning me that I'm connecting to this device, and it's presenting me with a certificate. Do I trust that certificate? Well, it's only going to ask me this the first time. If I say yes to this, that says I will trust the certificate, and I'll start a connection. Now, I've got this one set with a green font instead of gray so we can tell the difference between my SSH session and my console session. And so I can log in here. I'm going to log in as admin, and I'm going to provide that password that I set. And there we go. I'm logged into router 1, and I'm logged in via SSH. I can enable. I can provide that password that we specified, and I'm in a secure connection between me and the router on the other end. I can do a show SSH, and I can see that I've got an SSH version 2.0 connection in and out. It's encrypting using AES 256, which is a pretty strong encryption level, with a SHA-1 hash being used, again, on the session. So a very secure connection, and we're up and we're going. At this point, I could take my router, stick it in the networking closet or wherever, go back to my office, remote in using SSH, and we're in business. All right, let's do a quick recap of the commands that I had to do to get this operational. Let me bring up a little notepad window here. Or not. Good old, I've got the Notepad Plus. No wonder I was taking a little longer to run. All right, so the first thing I had to do was I had to assign a host name to my router, right? Your router has to have a host name, and you have to punch that in, as well as the domain name, IP, domain dash name, and whatever that domain name is. All right, so those are the first two commands I had to do. Once that was done, I was able to generate a certificate using crypto key generate RSA. And then I made sure to specify 1024 for the modulus. All right. After that was done, as soon as that certificate was generated, I got a message letting me know that SSH was enabled. I then created a username, set the privilege level, and set the password for that user account, and told it AAA new dash model to let it know it needed to ask for a username and a password. All right. Then I got into my VTY lines. Remember, 0 through 4 on a router, 0 through 15 on a switch. So a little bit different there, where I said transport input SSH to restrict it just to supporting SSH connections, if I can say it. All right. Once that was done, my device was ready to support the SSH connections, and I was able to remote in. All in all, very easy to do if we know the commands to punch in. All right, so now that you guys have seen that, you know there's no excuse for using telnet anymore. Really, we should try and get away from that as soon as possible. You don't want to send unencrypted data over your network if you don't have to. All right, well, that wraps up another demonstration. I hope you guys learned something, and look forward to seeing my next demonstration here soon.